We have a very special young lady on the phone with me, Miss Toni Tenille. Toni, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Arnie. I'm glad to be with you.
Okay, the big question is, why at this point did you decide to write your book? A memoir, Toni Tenille, a memoir, is that correct?
Yes, that's exactly right, which I wrote with my niece and co-author, Caroline Tenille St. Clair. Why did I decide to write it? Well, it took me a long time to make up my mind that I had to leave my husband and file for divorce. It's hard to explain it, but I knew that our fans, our longtime fans, would be disappointed when they heard about the divorce. Some would even be kind of devastated about it, and I wanted to explain how I came to that decision. It took me a very long time to make the decision. One of the main reasons was because I was concerned about the fans and what they would think about what I'd done. So this gave me a chance to explain it and hope that people would understand. And the interesting thing is that I would say 90% of what I've, feedback I've gotten from my readers is that they absolutely understand what I was getting at, what I was saying.
Well, from reading the book, it seems like there was, I hate to use the term abuse, but a lot of mental abuse more than physical abuse with the captain. Is that an accurate statement?
Well, let's put it this way. First of all, before I say anything more about Daryl, I'd love for your listeners to know that he and I still talk every week. We are friendly. We're friendly with each other, and I still defer to him on business decisions because he has a great business mind. But to explain the problems that we had, I came from a very loving family, and I have three wonderful sisters. I'm the oldest of four Tenille sisters. I had a great mom and dad who always encouraged me and thought I was talented, as they did all of my sisters. So we expressed love and affection for each other very easily. Daryl came from a completely different type of family. His father was a very, very famous symphony conductor, an arranger. He won the Academy Award for a cover girl, Rita Hayworth movie, for doing the scoring for that. Recorded 25 albums for Capitol Records. He was the epitome of the maestro, handsome and charismatic, but he was very, very hard on his kids. He had three sons and two daughters, and he was particularly hard on the boys and particularly hard on Daryl, because Daryl showed the most talent of all of them. He would criticize everything they did. Nothing they could do was good enough for him. And also, there was abuse. He would fly off the handle and hit them for no apparent reason. And so it was difficult. And plus, Daryl's mother had a breakdown when she was in her mid-30s and suffered from clinical depression the rest of her life. She lived into her early 80s, but she was depressed that entire time. And so she could never give him the love and affection that all the kids needed because she was so impaired. So he had no experience of that kind of love, of familial or, married love or anything like that. And consequently, this is what I think as I, began to try to help him. He just could not do it. He went inside himself. That's how he protected himself from all the negative input he was getting from his family, from his father in particular. And that's where he stayed. And I thought when I met him, first thing I thought was, oh my God, what a brilliant musician he was. And then I found myself falling in love with him, and with nothing from him that would let me know that he felt anything like that for me. The one thing I did know that he felt for me is he thought I was a great singer, and he thought I was a really fine songwriter. And that part I knew I could you know, please him by writing and singing and doing all those sorts of things. But I thought, okay, well, I'm going to spend this relationship with Daryl. You know, we were finally married in 1975, lived together starting in 72. I'm going to find the key. I'm going to open up his heart. Sounds so silly. And show him what the joy of life and the joy of music can be. He made all this great music, but he never seemed to be filled with joy of any sort for what he was doing. He just kind of did it. We could see a little spark in him every now and then when he played boogie. That was his favorite style. He loved Fats Domino and Little Richard and Jerry Lee Lewis and that type of piano. So I made it my mission to help him and bring him into the light, so to speak. And I worked at it for a very long time. He, in the meantime, one of the experiences or one of the manifestations of his problem was he was very, very much a hypochondriac. Anytime he heard about a new disease, he was sure he had it. And he was also a kind of a health food person. He was terribly afraid to eat certain things because he was afraid they would make him sick or create some new illness. So this was something we dealt with throughout our marriage. But he was just never capable of showing or giving any intimate affection, if you know what I mean.
Most definitely, most definitely.
You know, the other thing is, Arnie, I've been getting letters ever since the book has been out, which has been out since April 1st, from my readers who've said, oh my God, the story you told is my story. That's exactly what has happened to me. So many people, and I had no idea there were so many people who were experiencing the same thing that I did.
Okay. Would you like to mention a website or Facebook page or anything like that where people can leave comments or anything?
Absolutely. Absolutely. If they go to Tony Tenniel, on Facebook, The Real Tony Tenniel, and Tenniel is spelled T-E-N-N-I-L-L-E, two N's and two L's. I read my Facebook page every day, and I write back to people who've written to me on it, usually at least once a day. I'll sometimes check it twice. And also I'd like to point out that it's me. It's not anybody doing it for me. It is me doing the writing. So I would love to hear from people, you know, what they thought about the book, what they found in it that was interesting to them. And then also I'd like to mention, Arnie, that I did do the audiobook. I narrated the audiobook, which was a fabulous experience. I mean, I've recorded for years as a singer, but to read the words and tell my story that way from the very beginning, we read it from the very first word all the way through, totally unabridged. So it was an emotional but kind of a wonderful thing to do.
Okay, I know that you started singing in college with the Auburn Knights, but we're going to skip past that. Tell me, okay. How did you get involved with the Beach Boys?
Well, that was Daryl. Daryl had been working with them for, you know, as a backup musician for 5 or 6 years when I met him. I actually hired him to play in a musical I had written with a director at South Coast Repertory Theater in Southern California. It was a musical with an ecology theme called Mother Earth, and I hired him to play piano for me when he was between Beach Boy tours. And then when Mother Earth closed, he and I started working in clubs together, trying to, you know, figure out our own style until the Beach Boys were ready to go out again. And then Daryl told me one day, he said, I got a call from Carl Wilson, who is the middle Wilson brother, was the middle Wilson brother. At that time, Brian had stopped touring. And so Carl was the music director. And he called Daryl and he said, look, we're losing our acoustic piano player for a while. He wants to get his degree. So do you know anybody who can come and fill in? And Daryl said, yeah, I got this gal. She can do it. And Carl said, well, great. If you recommend her, I'm sure she's fine. He didn't even care that I was a girl. It was just fine with him. And they never heard me play until sound check for our first concert in Binghamton, New York. And that's the first time they heard me play. So I thought that was very open-minded of Carl, and also the fact that he took Daryl's word for it unheard.
Well, Carl was probably the least controversial of all the Wilson brothers, and just a super nice guy.
Oh,
we lost too
guy.
Quick.
Wonderful guy. I really liked him. He was so wonderful to me when I was out with them.
Well, I know that you and Bruce Johnston have had some different opinions, for lack of a better way of putting it. Tell us about Bruce Johnston.
Well, Bruce Johnston and Daryl knew each other, you know, when they were growing up. In fact, they worked in clubs together long before he ever met me. He would do club work in Malibu and around in there with Bruce or whoever other musicians were around, or with Daryl's own brothers, Dennis and Doug. And I met Bruce before Carl had me come to play play piano for them. He came to the Smokehouse where Daryl and I were working. That was the last club we worked in before we signed a record deal with A&M Records. And Bruce, and at that time we were doing Disney Girls, which Bruce had written in the club. I thought Bruce was one of the finest songwriters I've ever heard in my life. And we have recorded over the years many of his songs. He's just absolutely dynamite. But I will never forget when Bruce came into the Smokehouse he came in and he said, oh God, I'm trying to figure out how this went because I want to make sure you hear it exactly correctly. We were working there in the Smokehouse, and he decided that, God, I'm trying to remember how to put it, Arnie. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I've got a little blank thing going here because I'm trying to remember exactly how Bruce said it. Oh, he said that we would never make it because we were too old and nobody would ever be able to spell Tennille. And that was just Bruce's opinion. And, of course, at that point, I just kind of laughed off whatever Bruce thought. He always had a way of kind of digging at us and digging at me in particular, not necessarily Daryl, but digging at me. He just couldn't help himself. That was just the way he was. And he would give you maybe a tiny little compliment, and then he'd do something like, ah, you're too old. You know, that kind of thing. So I learned to just brush it off. At first I thought, what's he doing this for? But that's just been his style towards me, and I don't know why it was. But, I do know that when we recorded his If There Were Time, that Gordon Jenkins arranged for us, Bruce was not happy because Gordon Jenkins is very famous for doing his own style, doing chord substitutions. I mean, you know, he's arranged for Frank Sinatra and all of the big famous singers of that era. And I love what he did always, but Bruce was very upset and he hated the recording because of what Gordon had done to the chord structure. And I can understand that, because being a songwriter myself, I'm very careful about what chords I want. You know, I don't want it fooled around with. I want it done the way I did it. However, if somebody as brilliant as Gordon Jenkins had wanted to arrange one of my songs and do some chord substitutions, I would have said, well, that's great. I'd love to hear what he does with it. But anyway, I haven't talked to Bruce in quite a long time. I've talked to his wife. I've always been really friendly with Harriet. Bruce, although I don't know if they're still married, they may even be divorced right now, I'm not sure. But I haven't seen Bruce in a long time, and I don't even know if he's read my memoir. He might not even know these thoughts that I've had about him, because I don't do anything like that. You know, I don't say things. I just listen to what he says and say, okay, that's my style.
Well, you had said that you are a songwriter. Have you written anything that anybody other than the Captain and Tennille has recorded?
Yeah, some of them have recorded Do That to Me One More Time. And actually around the world, people have sent me links to YouTube videos where other, in different languages. That's kind of interesting. That was a, you know, the number one single that I wrote for us. And The Way I Want to Touch You, I believe, has been recorded. I have a lot of songs that that I'm very proud of that I've recorded on our albums that we never released as singles, that I was always too shy or too embarrassed to present to other artists, even though I thought they were really terrific songs. So that's one of the things that I'm going to do now that I'm old. You know, I'm just going to go ahead and say, here they are, and I especially have quite a few I'd love to hear some jazz artists do.
Okay. What gives you more pleasure, Tony, being a songwriter or being a singer-performer?
I love both. You know, and I'll have to say that when I was with Daryl, I was the most creative in as well as far as songwriting that I've ever been in my life. You know, I wrote so many of my songs about him, my feelings for him. The first song I ever wrote for him, The Way I Want to Touch You, I wrote when I was out on a Beach Boy tour, and he still didn't know how he felt about me. And that song became our second million-selling single after Love Will Keep Us Together. But, you know, I would, especially the songs I wrote about Daryl, I was always very careful when I wrote my lyrics that they expressed exactly how I felt, because I thought, well, I can't really tell him this, but I can write it, and maybe when he hears me sing it, you know, he will understand, and it may find a way into his heart. However, I found out years later when he told me he never pays any attention to lyrics. And knowing him as I know now, all he cares about is the music. And I'm sure when I was sitting there singing to him, I never wanted to touch a man the way I want to touch you, what he was thinking was, oh, my God, this mix is not good, or I don't like the way the bass sounds, or let me adjust this, you know. I'm sure that's where he was all that time.
Well, where is the book available, Tony?
All the Barnes & Nobles. In fact, I'm doing another signing for Barnes & Noble coming up in July. I'll be doing a book signing there here in Florida at a place called The Villages. And then you can get it on Amazon.com. You can go and find every version that's available, from the Audible version, from Audible Audio. It's even out on CD. You can get it in e-book form. You can get the hard copy. You can get in the regular brick and mortar stores. So you can find it just about anywhere.
Okay, tell us about "Love Will Keep Us Together." How did you happen to come up with that song, and what was it like to meet Sadaka afterwards?
Okay, I wish I could say I came up with that song. Actually, Neil Sadaka and Howie Greenfield wrote it. I did not write it. Neil is a very dear friend. I mean, I've just adored him ever since the first time I met him. He and I have a lot of things in common as far as the way we think about our writing. I heard the song first on an album that Neil had released only in the UK, and this was, I think he released it in 1974, and the A&R guy at A&M Records, Kip Cohen, who was the head there of it, called us in because we were just finishing our first album for A&M Records, and we felt like we needed an up-tempo song. We were looking for one, and he called us in and said, listen, you need to listen to these Sadaka tunes from this album he only released in the United Kingdom. And we listened to a couple of tunes, and they were great, and then we heard Love Will Keep Us Together. And we immediately, all of us, Kip and Daryl and I, immediately knew that was the song we were looking for. And the very next day we went into the studio, and within 3 days we had the track finished. And that's how we found the song. And then it was released as our first single in November, I believe it was, of 1974, and started climbing the charts. And in the meantime, Howie Greenfield, who had written the lyrics, had heard it on the radio, and he called up the record company, A&M, and he said, who is this singing this song? This is just a great record. Who is it? And they said, well, it's a new act we've signed. the captain and Tennille, and he said, "Are they black?" And and he said, "No." And he said, "Well, I really want to meet him." And so the first thing we did was we went and met Howie at his lovely home in Beverly Hills. And then when Neil came out from New York, where he was living after he left England, we met Neil at Howie's house. And that's how we got to know both of them. And, we lost Howie, unfortunately, to AIDS in 1986, which was heartbreaking because I loved that man. But Neil, he's still out there. He's still singing. He did tell me when I talked to him in New York about 6 weeks ago that he's going to actually retire next year, and I'll believe it when I see it. I don't think he's going to.
He's one of the guys on my bucket list I need to try to get a hold of, but he's a hard man to get a hold of.
Well, I don't know why that is, but he is a lovely man, and I've never seen anybody who loves performing more than Neil does. And it's just this incredible joy that just, and this connection between him and his audience, and of course all the great songs he wrote. And then everybody sings along, you know, Breaking Up Is Hard to Do and Laughter in the Rain and all those great songs he wrote, including the ones back in the, you know, late 50s, early 60s with Howie when they were teenagers.
Oh, you can't forget Calendar Girl.
Calendar Girl, that's the one I was going to say. Yeah, I mean, the audience starts singing along. It's just a big song fest and a love fest when Neil performs.
Well, we're going to do some jumping around right now.
Okay.
I want to ask you about Muskrat Love and Dr. Kissinger.
Okay.
Tell us a story.
What does Henry Kissinger have to do with Muskrat Love? Is that the story?
Yes.
Okay. Well, first of all, I need your listeners to know that Muskrat Love is something that Daryl and I actually tried out when we were working in the smokehouse. I'd heard it on the Top 40 radio. We were playing, you know, we were a Top 40 group, and I'd throw in some of the songs I'd written. But, you know, we'd play whatever was popular at the time and listen to the Top 40 all the time. And I was listening one day when Daryl and I were driving to the gig, and I said, "You know what? This is a song by America." And I said, "It sounds something like something about muskrats and love or something." And I said, "It sounds kind of funny. Let's go check out the music." So the next day we found the sheet music, and I started reading the lyrics, and it made me laugh out loud. I thought, this is hysterically funny, and it's kind of a cute tune, so let's work up an arrangement and try it out in the club and see what people think. Well, they went nuts. I mean, they went nuts. We could have played it six times a night if I would have allowed it. Finally just said, twice a night, that's all we're going to do. And then we put it on, we decided to put it on our second album for A&M. Before that album came out, we were invited to perform at the White House by President and Mrs. Ford. It was 1976, and it was the country's bicentennial celebration. Queen Elizabeth and Prince Philip were going to be there, and we were going to perform with Bob Hope. So we thought that was just a wonderful thing to do, and it was really just a fabulous experience, despite being a nervous wreck the whole time. But anyway, we were at our sound check in the East Room, and we're getting ready to take just a quick break, and Mrs. Ford came in, Betty Ford. What a lovely woman she was. And she said, we chatted for a minute, she and I, and she said, "Well, what are you gonna play tonight?" And I said, "Well, you know, we'll do Love Will Keep Us Together." And actually, I had decided not to do The Way I Want to Touch You, which was the only other hit we had at that time, because I thought it would be maybe a little too risque for the White House. So I'm, you know, telling her what we thought we might do, and she said, "Well, you're going to do The Way I Want to Touch You, aren't you?" And I said, and she said, "Oh, you must. That's mine and Jerry's favorite song." I thought, okay, that's pretty good. If she, you know, if she likes The Way I Want to Touch You, it's a pretty hip White House. So I went back and said to Daryl, "You know, Mrs. Ford wants to hear The Way I Want to Touch You." And I said, "Why don't we do Muskrat Love? I mean, why not? White House, Smokehouse, what's the difference? You know, they're all the same kind of people," I thought. So, in the East Room of the White House, I have to explain, it's a very small room, and it's really more suited to, you know, an opera singer accompanied by piano or something like that, because it's small. But anyway, so in the front row, the front row was, you know, probably 8 feet in front of me from where I sat at the electric piano, which I was playing at that time. And it, right in front of me was President and Mrs. Ford, and Queen Elizabeth and Prince Philip were there as well, Prime Minister of England and his wife. And right in front of me, about 8 feet from where I sat in the front row, was Henry Kissinger and his wife, Nancy. And so as we began, you know, we did the concert. It was going well. People seemed to be enjoying it. And then we started Muskrat Love. Well, when I started singing this song, you know, Muskrat Susie, Muskrat Sam, and, you know, do the jitterbug and Muskrat Land and all that, I could see Prince Philip was tapping his foot and nodding along, and Queen Elizabeth was kind of dozing a little bit. I think she was jet-lagged, but President and Mrs. Ford were smiling. Everybody in the front row was smiling except Henry. Dr. Kissinger immediately got totally stoned-faced. He wasn't having much fun anyway before that. And so when I started singing these words, and then we got to the point where Daryl does the muskrat sounds, you know, that he made up for the muskrats talking to each other or whatever it is they do. The look on Henry Kissinger's face was totally disgusted, and I saw him turn around to talk to somebody behind him, and I was, as I'm playing and singing, I'm thinking, what is he saying? You know, does he hate us? Is this some matter of state or something? Anyway, he turned back around and just stared stone-faced through the whole song, and I couldn't wait for the song to end. So we finally closed with Love Will Keep Us Together, and then after it was over, the Queen and Prince Philip and, you know, President Mrs. Ford and the others came up and you know, congratulated us and said how much they'd enjoyed it. And Henry Kissinger made a beeline out of there. The minute we did the last note, he was gone, and I've never seen him again. And so I kind of get my revenge, or got my revenge over the years, because every time I ever sang Muskrat Love in public, I dedicated it to Dr. Kissinger, wherever he may be. So I have no idea if he has any idea of his association with a couple of muskrats named Sam and Susie.
Great story, Tony. We are talking with Tony Tennille, formerly of the Captain Tennille. Most people don't realize that you did the background, or part of the background vocals on Pink Floyd's The Wall. Tell us about that.
Yeah, that was a fascinating experience. Bruce Johnston and I and Carl Wilson and a studio singer named John Joyce, if we were all in town together, we would sometimes do background work for, you know, any of our colleagues that would come into town. We did some work for Elton John. We did some for Art Garfunkel. And Bruce called me one day and he said, look, he said, Pink Floyd's in town and they're doing a new project and they want some background work done. Are you in? And I have to confess that I had heard their name. I wasn't really familiar with their music. You know, it was a rock thing, you know, heavy rock, I thought. And I had not really listened to Dark of the Moon or any of those other things. But I thought, this would be fascinating, because I always wanted to see how a rock group, you know, did their studio sessions. What was it like? And I told Bruce, yeah, I'd love to do it. And so I remember that it was a Sunday morning, which is kind of, seems to me kind of an odd time for a rock group to be doing a recording, but that's when it was, at a place called Producers Workshop in Hollywood. And Daryl went with me because he wanted to see how they ran a recording session too. So we walked in the front door, and Dave Gilmore was right there when we walked in, and he, you know, put out his hand and had a big smile, and he said, oh, I'm so glad to meet you. Thank you for coming. And I'm Dave Gilmore, and I said, I'm happy to meet you, Dave. And he said, I saw you on television this morning. And I thought, what in the world was this rock musician watching on Sunday morning TV? It turned out it was a kids show called Kids Are People Too that Daryl and I had guested on, and you know, recorded a few days before, and he was watching it with his kids that morning. So immediately, whatever image I had of, you know, groupies hanging around and people smoking dope went right out the window. And it turned out to be one of the most professional recording sessions I've ever done. I mean, it was very obvious they knew exactly what they wanted, exactly how they wanted it, and it was just a wonderful session. And when it was over, Dave said, "Now we're going to do our when this is done, we're going to do our first production of it here in Los Angeles. It's, you know, going to be the wall, and we're going to do our production here in Los Angeles. We'd love for you to come." And I said, "Oh, great." I said, "Just give me a call and, you know, let me know." I didn't realize what a big deal it was. He called me a few months later, and he said, "Tony, this is Dave Gilmore, and we're going to do our first production of The Wall at the Sports Arena here in Los Angeles, and we'd love for you and Daryl to come. And I've got tickets for you. You can just go pick them up at will call." So Daryl didn't want to go. He you know, what can I say? So I went with Bruce Johnston's wife, Harriet. She went with me. And we went there and got the tickets, and they were fabulous tickets, and it was absolutely fantastic. I mean, I don't know if you ever got a chance to see it, the actual production.
No, I haven't.
Oh, my God, it was just brilliant in every way. So we got to do that, and that was a really, really big thrill, and probably one of the top thrills I've had musically in a very long time.
Okay, we're starting to run a little bit low on time. A couple more questions.
Okay.
Real quick. Tell us about TV shows. You did the Captain Tennille, plus you had your own talk show. What was that like?
Well, yes, Daryl and I had the Captain and Tennille show in 1976 up and through 1980. We also did three specials for ABC, one in out of New Orleans and one in Hawaii, and then one that was all music, which I absolutely loved doing. So I also had my own talk show in 1980. Bob Eubanks, do you know who he is?
Yes, I do.
Yeah. Bob asked me if I'd be interested in doing a talk show, and my mother, back in Alabama in the 1950s, had had one of the first talk shows ever on the NBC affiliate there. She called it the Guest Room, and she was on for 5 years, 5 days a week, half hour a day, live. Everything was live then. And I used to go down, my sister Jane and I used to go down and watch her all the time do her thing. And so I was very comfortable with television, and I thought, yeah, this would be great, plus our TV show. And I loved the challenge and the thought of interviewing people and the chance to sing with some of my, you know, biggest idols, having them as guests on the show. So the show was only on for a year. It was syndicated, and like a lot of syndicated shows, it would show, for example, in New York City, it was right in the prime time, right before the local news and then right before the national news. It was perfect, got great ratings. But, you know, in some other places like Peoria, Illinois, or wherever it would be on at 3 o'clock in the morning. So it never had a specific time that it was on all around the country that we could get sponsors for it. But I will tell you that I am proudest of that, of just about anything I have ever done on my own. And there are many, many of the duets and things that I did on that show. You can find them on YouTube. And a lot of them were uploaded by a longtime fan who made it his business to record off the television, if no other way, almost every show I did, and then upload it to YouTube, because I've looked at some of those things that I don't even remember doing them. But when I see them, I go, oh, my God, that was so... We had a fabulous band. We had everybody that was working on that show loved that show. All the crew, everybody. It was fantastic. So I'm sorry it didn't go any further, but I sure loved when I did it, and I'm proud of the legacy I left behind on YouTube.
Well... The hardest question I'm going to ask you, Tony, is how did you handle the sex symbol image that you created, whether that was intentional or unintentional. You were, I think, everybody's fantasy at one point.
You know, I have to laugh when I hear that, because I never thought of myself that way. Honestly, I didn't, because there were certainly a lot more overtly sexy women around besides me. And, you know, I was married, so I never really thought that people would think of me that way. But it's kind of funny, because years and years later, we hired to play with Captain and Tennille, and also to work with me when I did symphonies and big bands, some musicians who had, young musicians, younger than we were, who admitted to me that I was kind of their dream girl when they were kids growing up. So I thought, well, that's nice to hear. Really nice to hear.
Well, being 5'10" with the very long legs, you gave that image.
I guess a big smile and a 5'11" actually, when I put those darn 3.5-inch heels on that killed my feet. Now my feet are destroyed because of them. I would be over 6 feet tall. So I guess that's kind of a neat thing.
Well, we are running low. One more question.
Okay.
What do you still want to accomplish, Tony?
Well, you know, I spent the last 8 years before I moved here to Florida back in August trying to make up my mind, you know, what to do about Daryl and what I was going to do about my relationship. And during that time, I never accepted any interviews, any national or international interviews. I just kept my head down and lived a kind of a regular life. I worked at the hospital there with my dog Smokey as a therapy team for 6 years. I got very into my Australian shepherds and, you know, things like that. I just led a kind of a normal and regular life. I never touched the piano that whole time, which is my instrument, you know. But I am starting to feel now that little bit is coming to me of creativity is coming back, because I never wrote a song during that time. But it's coming back, and I'm not sure exactly in what way it's going to be there. I'm letting it percolate, because I know it's going to be something good, and I'm just going to let life take me where it takes me.
Well, before I let you go, I'm going to ask you to play Disc Jockey, and if you would introduce Love Will Keep Us Together, we will get it up for our listening audience. I want to thank you so much for taking time to join me today. I know how much you love doing interviews, so we really, really appreciate it.
Well, thank you, Arnie, and don't forget to tell Bruce I said hi.
I will hopefully see him. I think it's either September or October he's going to be in the area, so I will definitely do that.
Okay, fantastic. All right, tell me when you're ready to.
I'm ready.
And now, this is Tony Tennille speaking. Here is a fantastic song written by Neil Sedaka and Howie Greenfield that was the hit of the summer of 1975. Do you remember where you were when you heard Love Will Keep Us Together?
Just gotta be strong, just stop. 'Cause I really love you.
the Captain and Tennille, and our special thanks to Tony for taking time to join me today. Don't forget her new book, Tony Tennille, a memoir.